Well, welcome. I want to say thank you to everybody who is watching on our Facebook page and on YouTube. I'm glad that you are able to hear this message on Mother's Day. One thing I want to talk about is our in-person church services. You know that the governor has said beginning the 20th of this month, we are allowed to have such services. Well, I'll be meeting with the deacons this week and talking about that because there are so many restrictions that have been put on. It's going to take us a while before we're able to get to that point. And I'm sorry for that, but we're putting the needs of our people physically above all things. We want to keep you safe. We want to keep you healthy. So we begin this Mother's Day asking you to pray for us as we make these decisions this coming week. And we'll get that information out to you right away. Before the message, I want to invite Keisha Blake to come, and she has a very special song today.
Dandelions all day, the first through the front.
Well, I want to invite you to open your Bible to Titus chapter 2. First of all, let me wish all of our moms a very happy Mother's Day. As I was thinking about Mother's Day, you know, it dawned on me that God could have populated this world in countless ways. We could have all come into this world some other way other than a mother and a father. But because God is God, there's no limit to the ways that he could have populated this planet. But God chose the family as the best way to do it. So knowing that, does it surprise you that Satan has pointed all the artillery of hell at the home? I mean, families are under attack more today than at any other time. And it seems that the home is made up like a prison cell. There are all different kinds of cells. Everybody is in their own cell and they have their own television and they get lost in their in that cell. Everyone just doing their own thing. And every cell has their own cell phone. You know, it never dawned on me before now what a cell phone might be named after, because that's exactly what they have done. They have caused us to isolate ourselves in the world normally, even without the self-isolation that is in place. I've got good news, though, today. God has a plan. You know the old expression, when all else fails, read the directions. Now, men, this is Mother's Day, so I'm not talking to you, because men, we just don't like to read the instructions, whether we're putting together a toy or having preparing a trip and making a roadmap. So this is for the ladies. I think that there's no better way to honor the women of Mount Pisgah and our guests than to lift up some great truths that God has inspired in his word for your benefit. We're in Titus chapter 2, verse 1 begins and says, "But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine, that the aged man be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience, that the aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed." There are two words that set up this text for the context. One is found in verse 1. The other is down in verse 10. The words are become and adorn. In verse 1, it's the word become. Ladies, maybe you have said this to a friend and told them that what they're wearing, their outfit, that dress, the shoes, whatever, is very becoming. Well, that's the word it used in verse 1. To become literally means that she beautifies. In the context of Titus chapter 2, she is beautifying sound doctrine. And in verse 10, the word adorn comes from the Greek word where we get our word cosmetic in the English language. If you really want to be beautiful, not just outwardly, but I'm talking about inwardly, you need more than Estee Lauder. You need more than Sephora. You need to live God's way according to God's plan. Now, I found these makeup tips that are going to help you. The first thing you have to do with your makeup is put on the foundation of godliness. And then you wear the blush of purity and innocence. After that, apply the eyeliner of compassion. And then add the mascara of sincerity. And finally, put on the lipstick of a kind tongue. Now, back this up a little bit and write those things down, because they will be very helpful to you. And what it teaches us is that beauty does not come from what you put on. Beauty comes from within. So we're going to look today at the things which adorn, which become which beautify sound doctrine. And I hope that every woman here today will leave with a bag full of spiritual cosmetics, with an irresistible spiritual attraction that will catch the eye of a lost world beyond our doors. The first thing I want to talk about in our text is the mandate of the woman. That is found in verses 3 and 4, where it tells the woman that her mandate is to teach the young women. There is no way around it. What the young women of Mount Pisgah Baptist Church are supposed to learn about Christian womanhood, they are not supposed to learn primarily from this pulpit, from this pastor, but rather from the other ladies that are right here. Our women have a God-given responsibility to teach younger women how to be good wives, good mothers, good homemakers. The younger women also have a responsibility, according to the Word of God, that it is to listen. They are to listen to the older women and to avail themselves of their wisdom. Beloved, who is teaching the younger Christian women of today? Who is shaping their family values? Well, I'm afraid in many cases it's someone like Oprah. The world is sending all kinds of negative messages to our younger women. Here's what they say. If you're not happy, if you're not satisfied with that old goat that you're living with, just leave him. After all, you have a right to be happy. Well, we need women who have been married for years to step up and say, you have the right to keep your commitment. You have a right to keep your vow before God. And it's not your love that sustains your commitment. It's your commitment that will sustain your love. We need some women to say that we've all shared the problems. Some of my problems were bigger than the problems you have. I've had more problems than you've had, but it works because of commitment. The world says if this pregnancy is unplanned, then simply make a plan to get rid of it. Our godly women need to respond to that and teach that the circumstances which surround a pregnancy do not determine the value of the child. Maybe that woman needs to say to the younger woman, I've experienced an unplanned pregnancy. Now let me tell you what that has done in my life. Let me tell you what they have done with their life and how the surprise goes on day after day. I need to tell you, 20 years ago, we lost a child. The doctors warned us after that having more children would not be good. Well, we had another unplanned pregnancy. That unplanned pregnancy that the doctor said we shouldn't have, the doctors even said we couldn't have, is going to turn 18 this October. She's going to graduate high school in 2021. She's probably going to go to college and become great. Now, I know as I've read this text and I've preached, I'm trying to leave the word older out. There's not a woman in this world that appreciates that old English word in our text that says aged. It's just not a pretty word. We're not talking about the elderly. I want you to understand that. By definition, what we're talking about is those who have had children and their children have grown and maybe they've left the house or soon they will leave. See, if you fit that category, the Bible teaches today that it reminds you that you have a mandate. And a mandate is not a suggestion. It's not an idea if you're interested. It's a command. And if you're not investing your life into the lives of these younger women, then you're not fulfilling all of your God-given responsibility as a woman. Well, the question that number one arises is, why should I? Why should I obey that mandate? Well, let's see her motive. What is the motive of the godly woman? Well, we don't have to guess what that is. It's telling us right here at the end of verse 5, the motive is that the word of God be not blasphemed. That word blaspheme means vilified, defamed, reviled. You say, well, what does that have to do with me? Well, simply put, the best thing that you can do to improve the influence of this church and even the influence of the gospel of Jesus Christ is to build strong families. Anytime the community learns of a family that falls apart in the church, it contradicts, it undermines, it marginalizes what we teach and preach here. It hurts our influence. We're preaching that Jesus is the answer to the world's problems, that Jesus is the solid rock on which we are to build a marriage and to build our home. But for the most part, the world doesn't listen to what we say, but oh my goodness, they do watch what we do. And Paul is saying that when we allow our homes and our churches to disintegrate, the word of God is blasphemed. Now, please don't misunderstand. We are here to help the hurting. That's the right thing to do. That develops influence too. So that man, that woman who the spouse has left can remain a testimony of God by staying in church, by staying close to God. And we have many like that in the church today. But it's a shame when these things are happening right under our noses where there was something that we could have done about it, and we didn't. We do it so that the gospel of Jesus Christ, the message of Jesus Christ, is not defamed. Well, not only does Paul talk about the mandate and the motive, he goes on to talk about her manner of life. Verse 3 says that they be in behavior as becometh holiness. Now, that word behavior is a word where we get the word fragrance. You should have the fragrance of holiness emanating from you. What does that exactly mean? Well, if we go back into the Old Testament times, the priest who would go into the Holy of Holies, they would burn incense unto the Lord, and incense was a sweet-smelling smoke that went up to God. It represented our prayers and our praise. Well, as they would depart from the Holy of Holies, that fragrance still stuck to their garments. And as they passed by the people, they knew that that priest had been in the presence of God. Well, beloved, that's exactly what we need the women of our church to be like, that people will see it in your life. They will see it in your walk that you have been with the Lord, so that when anyone gets around you, they know that you've been in a holy place. They know that you have been with the Lord. The beauty of Christ just radiates from a godly woman. There is a list of things that she is or does to give her this aura, this glow. Things like it tells us not to be a false accuser. Literally, what that means is to not be a gossip. Now listen, I understand there is not a single gossip in this church. That is just like it. There's not a single guilty person in any prison across America. You see, we want to believe that we are not a gossip, but how many times have you heard someone else say, "Well, you know me, I don't gossip, but," and they go and they tell you a story. Well, beloved, anytime you do something and you don't even know what you're doing, that is a form of insanity. We can't be that way. We have to not be given to gossip. And also it says not to be given to much wine. That simply means they should be in control of their faculties. You see, a drunk person has little control of their tongue. A drunk person has little control of their body. Little control of their mind, of their thoughts. So we have a mandate. The women are to teach younger. younger are to look to those who have been there, done that in their marriage, in their child rearing. The motive is that the word of God will not be blasphemed. And their manner of life ought to reflect that. They ought to have a life of holiness, of wholesomeness, a healthy life spiritually. But finally today, I want you to know that God gives a woman her message. He gives her the message. He says in verse 4 that they may teach. God will give you the message that you are to communicate to the younger women. So what specifically are the women supposed to teach the younger? Well, a lot of that has to do with what they are already. Like we said, a godly woman is not to be given to much wine. Well, the first thing she's to teach another woman is how to be sober. And again, that means discreet. This means serious-minded, level-headed, have good judgment. That's why the husband of the godly woman in Proverbs 31 safely trusts her. He trusts her to make good decisions, to run the house well, to use time wisely. Well, the Bible says, doesn't say that you have to be a good cook to be a godly woman. It's like the man said, if the stove was as hot as the TV, I could get a good hot meal around here. But there was a couple who just finished their honeymoon, and the woman confessed she's not a great cook. She goes, all I know how to cook is meatloaf and banana pudding. She made the first dinner when they got home and set it before him, and he said, honey, I don't care if you're not a good cook, but just tell me which one is the meatloaf and which one is the banana pudding. You don't have to be a great cook, but the Bible says you should be level-headed, serious-minded, use good judgment. Not like the guy who said, honey, you must think I'm a perfect idiot. And she said, no, dear, no one's perfect. Ladies, your message to other women is to love your husband. That's what verse 4 tells you. You need to teach them, love your husband. Now, do you really think that we need to learn to love? Well, you remember how things were back in the Bible time? Today, we fall in love and then we get married. But back then, it's reversed. The marriage was arranged by the parents. And though we don't do it that way today, the fact remains, according to the Bible, we can learn to love him. You see, a lot of times as the marriage goes on, they say things and do things that make you wonder, did I make a mistake? And that's because that love has to grow. And we need to grow in love. Behind every command that God gives us, and that's a command that wives are to love their husbands, every command of God is from an omnipotent, all-powerful God who enables you to do anything that he commands that you do, if you will trust and obey. And you can do that with his help. Now, if you are a person who has been married for 5 years, you are a part of this. You can be teaching newlyweds. If you have been married for 20 years, you can be teaching those who have been married for 10 years. And it just goes on and on. It is your responsibility to teach the younger women how to love their husband, how they can make it for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, or more. Think about this just for a moment. These that have been married for 20 and 30 years and more, they have gone through what the younger women are going through, and yet they stayed married. They stayed married because they were committed to that marriage. If we would just stop worrying about what the rest of the world is doing and be committed to our commitments, we'll find that these women who have been married for 20 and 30 and 40 years, they have had at times to learn to love. And just look at those guys that they have had to learn to love. Only God can get the glory. Your message to the younger women is to love their children. Now, again, do we really need to learn to love the child? Well, you know what? When they're a little bitty baby and they're just so cute and cuddly, it's easy to love them. And then they don't go to sleep all through the night. All through the day they sleep, but you can't. You've got other things to do, and at night they don't sleep again. You need to learn to love. And then the worst thing happens. They become teenagers, and you've got to learn to love them all over again. We need to learn to love our children. And that is something that young women who have not been married need to know today. Some people say that the womb is the safest place for a child, but that's not true in our life anymore. Then there's the modern mother today who says, I love my child too much to spank them. I know I'm going to get a lot in trouble for this, but you need to know, young mom, that the Word of God teaches that love means that we spare not the rod. I don't believe in child abuse, not one bit. I think that that's wrong. There's a wrong way, but there is a right way to chasten a child. It's not politically correct, but beloved, it is biblically correct. God says to teach a woman how to be chaste. Now, that's an easy one. Every time the children leave the home, dad chases that wife all over the place. I found out that's not what that word means. It really is an old-fashioned word that means purity, innocence, clean, pure. Teach these younger women to have premarital purity and postmarital fidelity. We leave it up to the school system to raise the young women today. You know, that same school system that kicked God out when they were young. And to think that it is capable of teaching sex education correctly is absolutely absurd. It's not up to the school. We need some women who will teach the younger women by example and in the Word how to be chaste. And we need mothers who will do the same for their daughters. You know, I've actually had a Christian mom who told me that she told her daughter, if you can't be good, be careful. Don't you know that sends the wrong message? The home is under attack today. And so when all else fails, read the directions. I'm so thankful today for mothers, women of God, as they raise their children as more mature women teach the younger women. As Mother's Day today, it's a day to honor them, but it's also the Lord's Day, and it's a day to glorify God. I can't think of anything more that would glorify God than for a woman to recommit themselves to this mandate, to teach and to learn from each other, to begin to establish that irresistible glow of godliness, the attractive scent of one who has been with God, the fragrance of holiness. And if you're here listening today and you do not know Jesus as your personal Savior, a man or woman, young person, whoever, number one way for God, for women, God's number one way for everyone is that we be born again. It starts there. It would be wonderful to have a woman saved today, or perhaps for a mother's prayer to be answered today for her child, that they would be saved. If that is your need, I would ask that you would respond to the Holy Spirit right now and just ask Jesus to save you, to come into your heart, to forgive you of your sin. If you are online, you can change over in just a moment and just type in a search for the Romans Road. Go through that and see. It's very simple. It's like ABC. Admit to God that you're a sinner. Believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead and that he'll save you. And C, commit your life to him. If you do that, you could be a child of God today. And let me tell you, call your mom. Let her know that you know that she has been praying for you and that you finally asked Jesus into your heart. Nothing would make her day better. We're going to have a word of prayer, and then we're going to sing the wonderful song that we sing every Sunday, I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for mothers. We thank you for the work that they do in our lives, how they have raised us. My mother has been gone for years and years, and yet I still remember the words of wisdom that she shared with me and how right she always was. I pray that we would understand that. And I pray the women of our church today, the women who are already saved, that they would begin to invest their lives into the lives of younger women and help them as they then become good wives, good mothers for their own families. Lord God, I pray that you would bless this message in a very special way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you and have a wonderful Mother's Day.